us understand when it's time to treat. Certain patients, as you said, don't really need treatment right away because they're asymptomatic. So which patient type should begin to get treatment?
That's really the most important aspect of the discussion, I would say, because from my perspective, you know, been doing this for almost a decade, you know, I've seen probably 3,000 or 4,000 patients with Waldenstroms in my career. I think one of the most important decisions is when to treat. You know, a number of our patients will be asymptomatic and they will remain asymptomatic for years. So really treatment initiation in this scenario is not reasonable. Number one, we don't cure the disease. Number two, patients have a long survival. I'm talking about, you know, 15, 20 years of survival in a large proportion of patients. So a treatment that is going to last a year is not going to change a 20-year survival. So we don't extend the survival of our patients in most cases.
Right. If a patient has been on watch and wait, how do you know when it's time to begin therapy?
Yeah, so essentially when we see patients in whom we decide to monitor, right, watch and wait, we just monitor them, mm-hmm. We follow them over time. You know, and we see them sometimes every 3 months, every 6 months, and we get blood work. We will blood work on those patients to look at the hemoglobin just to see if there's anemia or not, to look at the IgM to see if it gets to be too high or not. And if the IgM is too high, sometimes we have the patients have eye examinations on a yearly basis to make sure that there's no changes in the vessels, in the back of the eyes, in the retinas. That's an indication of hyperviscosity. And every time we see them, not only we look at the numbers, which I think is important, but we also look at the symptoms. You know, so I classically ask my patients, how's your energy level? How well you're doing? Still able to do everything you want to do? Any numbness on your feet, right? Any nosebleeds, any headaches, any blurred vision, right? Any lumps? So, I mean, I just go over this list of different symptoms that patients can experience. Are you having fevers? Are you having night sweats? Are you losing weight for no reason, right? So it's a monitoring process. Just to clarify further, for example, a patient can come to see me with anemia. And I know that Waldenstrom's causes anemia, as I said before, but it is my duty as a doctor to make sure that there's no other reason why the patient might be anemic, right? So even though in the scenario in which it's very likely that the disease is causing this problem, I still need to make sure that it is not that is not something else, you know, driving this anemia for the patient, and then the anemia is severe enough. You know, some patients say, yeah, I mean, I'm a little tired, but I'm still able to do everything I want to do. So really that's a very minor process. And there are people who tell me, you know what, I cannot play with my children anymore, right, because I'm so tired. Then that's a different process. So the severity of the symptom and how related to the disease is, that combination is what really tells us who needs to be treated or not. So what I would say, in terms of treatment timing for Waldenstrom patients, it's not that you need treatment and then you don't need it and then you need it. It's not like that. It's more like you don't need it, and then it is reasonable to treat, and there's a period in which it's reasonable to treat, and that period can last sometimes months to years. Oh. Some patients can decide to be treated a little earlier in the process with less symptoms, and some patients can decide to be treated a bit later with a bit more symptoms. So it has to do a lot with, you know, the patients, how they feel, how they're tolerating the symptoms, how dangerous or potentially threatening those symptoms are. And that's a conversation that it needs to take, you know, place between the doctor and the patients, understanding the patient's preferences.